Hey guys, what's up? I have a full show for you. I think I have like 13 titles, so that's got to be a record for me. I know that one of the end of the year shows had like 12 to 13 titles, and also if I look like I'm grabbing, got a little stiff neck for some reason, I must have pulled it doing something stupid. But I want to start this show out with talking about a couple things. I added a couple tiers on the Patreon. One was a deal where you could leave have a voice message or a video play in the weekly show. If it's a conversation starter or if it's just something like a question, you can have it play over the show. Or you can ask a question to the audience. I think that's cool. You can have your question asked to the audience and they can answer if they want to. I think that would be fun. And I also added a tier called Franchise Face-Off, where basically if someone picks two franchises, for example, you pick Nightmare on Elm Street and Friday the 13th, every week I will watch the first of the franchise. I watch Nightmare on Elm Street and Friday the 13th, and I'll compare them, pick which one I think is a better movie, which one I prefer better, and whatnot. And then next week I'll do part twos of each series. And I'll keep doing that until we run out of one of the series. So, and at the very end, there'll be some examples and some changes from series to series. And at the very end, I'll say which one's the better series as far as it's concerned when we're going tick for tack, one for one, you know. And so Friday the 13th, we go up to the first seven. Because Nightmare on Elm Street has seven in the series. And then I do the remakes too. So it'd be eight, basically 16 titles and a tier. And it would be over, how many weeks would that be? Eight movies, eight. So it'd be over 8 weeks. So if that sounds like something you guys be interested in, then check it out. Also, I was wondering, I'm going to ask this, I'm not going to do ratings on this episode, but do you guys want me to give ratings like out of 10? I don't know. Some people like the ratings, some people don't. I'm willing to do the ratings because I rate stuff on Letterboxd and, you know, anyways, so it really doesn't matter for me. But if you guys want ratings, I don't know. It's so hard to rate some stuff, especially when it's not necessarily just a review. It's more of a, not necessarily analytic or a review. It's just somewhere in the middle. I just talk about movies I enjoy and the releases and whatnot. So it's up to you guys if you want to see ratings on some of these movies. And I also, the last thing I wanted to mention before we get into the reviews is the Portraits of Andrea Palmer trailer dropped. That's being released. That was a kind of a hardcore film I watched and reviewed a while ago. It was a secret screening. There was no trailer at the time. It's a weird movie. It's like a dark drama, like porn movie. It's kind of strange. It's unique. It's pretty cool. The trailer will play in a little bit. Check it out. There's no nudity or anything super explicit in the trailer. It's I guess it's YouTube safe. So if you want to check it out, and there'll be links for that below, so check out the trailer.
How long you been in town?
For a few days.
Where are you staying?
Somewhere downtown.
I just want to have fun today.
Right. I'm glad I know the lick of heaven. I'm glad I had a sense at hell. I'm glad I lived. I'm glad I left before the slow black curtain fell. I'm glad that I can madly laugh. I'm glad that I don't give a damn to see myself a tawdry thing. I'm glad, oh God, like hell I am.
Okay, guys, we're going to start out with something special. The first review is the 3-disc edition of Lucio Fulci's Zombie. Come on, guys. Blue Underground did an amazing job, first and foremost. Everybody knows Zombie. It's Lucio Fulci, masterpiece. It's probably his most popular film. I don't know if it's the fan favorite anymore. But Zombie, what can I say? Inspired to be made after the success of Night of the Living Dead, Dawn of the Dead in 78. This was made in 79. And it follows the story of a reporter and a daughter of a scientist who go missing on a tropical island to kind of figure out why this boat showed up in the New York Harbor with a weird creature on it that attacked one of the cops and killed him. So they go to find this news story. They team up with this couple. One's played by Al Cleaver, however you say it, And they end up on this island that is overrun by zombies. That's the setup of this movie, and it sounds fairly typical, but it is one of the best zombie movies ever made. And for Fulci, it's a little different, because Fulci didn't write this script, and it feels more like an adventure film. Fulci was a jack of all trades before this movie. Fulci could do all. You know, he did giallo, he did comedy, he did westerns, he did science fiction, he did crime films. After this one, Fulci had a long career with horror films. And in this time span, shortly after, he would do stuff like City of the Living Dead, The Beyond, House by the Cemetery. Tons and tons of stuff. I don't know how to talk about Zombie without just gushing about it in ridiculous levels and almost just becoming like a little, fanboy and screaming and yelling how great it is. But I'll get that off my chest right off the bat. Zombie is probably, I know you can't take Romero out of the equation of zombies, but without Romero, in Return of the Living Dead, it's probably the best zombie movie, for me, at least. I think it's amazing. Kind of inspired by Zombie, but it also has the voodoo aspects and the superstitious stuff that Fulci was so known for having, which I love. I've always loved that about Fulci, is his, you know, his kind of comments about superstition, whether it be Catholicism or, you know, other religions. He always has a message in that. It has the classic, you know, obsession with eyes. Fulci has the eyes here, and it plays into the scene in one of the most gratuitous scenes in the entire film. There's so much stuff in here that's different for Fulci. A lot of it feels like a comic book. How often do you see a girl in a thong, topless, go scuba diving and run into a zombie underwater that ends up fighting a shark? That whole thing is cut from a comic book. It's amazing. The Fabio Frizzi score is one of the most memorable. The climax of the film is action-packed, and it has some of the great camera shots that I love when it follows Al Cleaver with the gun like that. That stuff does it a couple times. It's great. The special effects by Giannetti De Rossi are some of the best. De Rossi did all the big ones. You know, he worked on Cannibal Holocaust. He worked on, I believe, The Beyond. He is probably the most underrated special effects guy ever, to me, at least. And the effects in this movie are great on the rotting corpses. There's some strange things in here, as it said, in, you know, guys know the story about Zombie being the sequel to Dawn of the Dead in Europe, so it was called Zombie 2. In reality, it plays better as a prequel to Dawn of the Dead, but the rules are not necessarily the same. We have a lot of superstitious stuff going on here, and the only way I try to tie it into Dawn of the Dead and say, because in the Romero's universe, if you die, you come back, no matter if it's a bite or infection or a sickness, you die, you come back. The bite kills you. It makes you sick, it's infected, kind of like a septic bite. You die, you come back, no matter what. And this one, it seems to have that element, but everybody seems to get a strange sickness. And I was wondering, do you think this strange sickness was just brought on by something on the island and everyone was dying from the sickness and coming back as zombies? But then it spreads to the mainland. So it's definitely a different set of rules. And you don't necessarily know if it's scientific or superstitious, which causes the zombie outbreak. But we have some of those classic, like, EC comic style stuff where the conquistadores buried their rise from the grave. Of course they would be rotted to nothing. Who cares? It's fun, it's awesome, it's gory, it's action-packed. It's one of these movies that has so many memorable things in it. Iconic shots like the end, the zombies on the bridge, the zombie poster art, the splinter in the eye, the zombie versus shark, Captain Haggerty, the big fat zombie on the boat. You know, great, great zombie there. This movie is one of my all-time favorite movies, if you guys haven't realized that. The new features that they added are actually very welcome. We have a Stephen Thrower appreciation on Zombie. Stephen Thrower is one of the best. He talks about it. He goes in depth. I really like listening to that. We have a Troy Howarth commentary, which is also a treat. Troy Howarth does a bunch of commentaries on the Italian films, and he goes into depth about these people's career and whatnot. And he loved Richard Johnson in this movie, and that's for good reason. Richard Johnson in Zombie is like the classic actor you have to have in your movie. So he worked perfectly in this one. And he's like the Donald Pleasance of Halloween in this one. And he does a great job. But just amazing special effects all the way around. The zombies are rotted and gross. I would put these up there. My two favorite zombies are from Day of the Dead and Zombie. I think they look the best. I think they're the top notch. And just some amazing, great shots. You know, when they pan out and they show my son was dead in the village or something like that, and then they pan out and they show the one zombie just walking through the village and it goes out into a wide. Just wonderful stuff, like I said. I love that the actor Ian McKellen would go on to basically do two zombie ripoffs after this, Contamination. All three of the movies he did like this all ended on the Video Nasties list. So Zombie, Contamination, which he did, which opens up with the harbor scene like a zombie, and then Zombie Holocaust, which mixes zombies and cannibals. All three of the movies he ended up doing ended up on the Video Nasties list. Tisa Farrow, or Farrow, is actually in this one. Mia Farrow's sister, which is kind of strange. She's in other stuff like Fingers and Last Hunter and some other Italian horror movies as well. Anthropophagus, or however you say it. I've always said Anthropophagus. But regardless, this is a great release. All the old features are ported over from the Blu-rays, from the Blue Underground stuff. It looks good, and it looks so good. It's the first time I ever noticed blemishes in Zombie. I've never been able to catch the makeup things, and the zombie underwater, I could see some, you know, some seams showing, and that was the first time I ever could see that. I can't take points away for that. Zombie to me is perfect. It'll always be perfect. It was one of the first Italian horror films I saw at a pretty young age, and it was one of those ones that always got a bad rep in the review books when I was a kid. I'd look through it. Unauthorized George Romero zombie sequel. Turkey. It's like, are you crazy? I don't think you've ever seen this movie. I think maybe you couldn't get past the fact that they considered it a Dawn of the Dead sequel in Europe. But regardless, it's a wonderful movie with a great special effects, great atmosphere, and it's different for Fulci. It feels like an adventure film, action film. There's lots of action in here. It's not like his atmospheric horror movies. Although it is atmospheric, it has its own haunting atmosphere, not similar to his other, you know, Gates of Hell movies or stuff like that. But I'd really recommend checking this release out. It looks very good. It sounds very good. The Fabio Frizzi score comes through your surround sound. It sounds damn great. And it looks amazing too. And just a wonderful movie. There's an introduction by Del Toro on here, which is always welcome. And I know this is one of his favorite horror movies, and for good reason. It should be one of everybody's favorite horror movies if you can get past the gory, gory gut munching. Oh, also it has Dakar in here, who would go on to be in Zombie Holocaust as well with Ian McCulloch. So yeah, a great release, loaded with features. This has all the stuff, like I said. Two Blu-rays fill the features and the soundtrack. It looks damn good, it sounds damn good, and finally Zombie gets the respect it deserves. Okay, guys, the next one, also by Blue Underground, also an amazing release. It is William Lustig's classic exploitation sickie, Maniac, starring the wonderful Joe Spinell. Yeah, everybody's, again, familiar with Maniac, and everybody's probably saying, why did I buy Zombie 70 times? Why did I buy Maniac 70 times? You're buying these movies one more time because they're rescanned in 4K. They look amazing. Maniac was one of these movies that never looked particularly great, okay? There's lots of out-of-focus shots, some soft-focus, stuff like that. It's always been gritty, too, at times. It's a low-budget movie. It never was made to look beautiful, never had the budget to look amazing, but that aesthetic always worked for Maniac. And this new release, it looks better than it ever did, and I think it looks pretty great. Maniac is the story of Frank Zito, a serial killer with mommy issues that goes around scalping women and putting them on mannequins in his apartment. He runs into this girl, Carolyn, played by Carolyn Monroe, and they start to form sort of this strange friendly relationship, which is not going to end well. Maniac is known infamously for its gratuitous violence and its, I guess, misogynistic qualities that a lot of people said it had. I don't agree with that kind of stuff. I don't agree with censorship in general. But, okay, let's get into Maniac. You know, what's funny about Maniac is William Lustig knew movies. He knew horror movies. He's been working on movies before he made this. He had made this at the age of 24. He'd been working on movies, he said, for 8 years before this. So that is amazing to know that William Lustig had been working in film for his entire life. He even has a cameo in this, of course, you would. But Lustig, you know, takes a lot of these qualities from other horror movies, the doll aspect, that he has these mannequins like Tourist Trap, or these weird dolls, little dolls have always been in horror movies, and they're in this movie, and they're all around, and it's very creepy. He also, essentially, the plot of this movie is Psycho, but instead of like some area where it's more rural, it is a city. It's gritty New York City Psycho. And it's violent and it's gory. It's exploitation style. It has Tom Savini gore effects. It takes all those things from the horror movie aspects. It has the suspense too. And the way that William Lustig takes his camera shots are very, very strange. His choices are different at the time, to me at least. And I mean, maybe not necessarily one choice here or there, but the mixture of choices is different to me. When William Lustig is stalking, Joe Spinell or Frank Zito is stalking a woman, a nurse in the subway, we start off with her and we see points of views of her going through the train thing, the conveyor thing. We see a point of view from the train when she misses it. We see their feet walking. It's just such a strange, unsettling way to build suspense, and it works perfectly well. I can't really go on and talk about this movie much without mentioning the effects again, the head explosion. It's just top-notch. And I gotta say this about Joe Spinell. Elric Kane from the Shockwaves podcast and Pure Cinema podcast has one of the best quotes I've heard about Joe Spinell. He had poetry in his eyes. And that is a great way to put him. Joe Spinell was one of these actors, these character actors, who popped up in a lot of big movies in smaller roles. He was in Big Wednesday. He was in Cruisin'. He was in The Godfather. He was in Rocky. He was in everything. You'd see Joe Spinell pop up in every movie, always doing a great job, always in a smaller role. And this one, he plays the lead, which was exciting to see. And Spinell is great at being scary and intimidating and gross, but also having a childlike quality. And this childlike quality is genius in the movie when we see Joe Spinell dismantling a shotgun, and then he stops and just by you don't see him in the shot, but you see his arms and stuff dismantling shotgun to take it on the road to kill somebody. And he picks up a thing of Cracker Jack and starts eating it. It's just like that explains everything who Joe Spinell is in this movie. He never got past that phase with his mother. He is a child. At times he's sitting in a little boy outfit, just saddened. And there's like two Zitos in this movie. We have the childlike one and the killer, but we also have that's like the one, but we have another side to him where he can be suave, where he can be, you know, talk to people and be very full of charisma, charismatic. And I think that's pretty ingenious and realistic with a lot of these killers. Because if you were just to tear this, they said it's tore right out of the headlines, and it is. If you were to see these stories, see these elements that make a killer, you'd be like, oh, that's a real story. That's a real killer. Like, this is like Edmund Kemper meets Ed Gein or something like that. It feels like a legitimate killer. And it's one of the sleaziest, grittiest movies, and it's not a good experience, and the ending is surreal, and I love it. I just really like this one. I think it's well worth your time. I think it's just one of those classic, you know, gritty New York horror movies that we don't get enough of, on par with something like New York Ripper. Probably better than New York Ripper, even though I enjoy that one as well, which is crazy because there's a comic where I guess these two fight, the Duck Killer and Frank Zito. I've not had a chance to read it. But it's a great movie. I would recommend it if you're big into horror movies. This is a movie that, you know, I can't believe that on the features, which I love, they had all these outcries and these people talking bad about it and going out. And they're so hypocritical when they go into things. And it's just strange how they say that. They're like, women are being stalked on the streets like this every day and killed. And they're explaining it. And then the next person will be like, well, this is going to inspire people to kill people. It's like, I thought they were already doing it. And you're mad that they're exploiting it. Now you're upset that they're inspiring. What is it? You can't. You're just upset because it's something that affected you that is too real. And I never have been one to say to stop reality from being shown in movies. I know people say it's an escape. I want to escape from it, but I think it's good to sometimes see horrible things to realize that horrible things do happen to people and to try to help people. I don't know. There's a million different ways I can look at it. And at the end of the day, it's fake. It's a movie. There's some new features on here, which I'll talk about. Lustig goes around town, and he starts to look at some of the locations and talk about how things have changed. He talks about, Joe Spinell a bit, which is kind of touching, very touching, actually, and sad. And he has a speech in there where he says, if you want to do something, don't procrastinate. Do it now, because time goes by so fucking fast. And William Lustig is one of these guys that just has a great voice, and he's very intelligent about film and whatnot. And also the best thing on here for the new releases, there's all the old stuff ported over as well, is a great outtakes, like 19 minutes of outtakes and behind the scenes, and Lustig's talking over it, and this stuff is all remastered too, and it's all going down 42nd Street and seeing the marquees and seeing all the movies playing there, and you're just like, man, this stuff is a gold mine, and it's just so cool to see the differences later on too with the other feature. But I just like seeing that, and you get to see Joe Spinell goof a little bit behind the scenes. A great release, looks great, has tons of stuff, also comes with the frickin' soundtrack, and the second disc is a Blu-ray too with all the features loaded over. Carolyn Monroe interview, Tom Savini interview, lots of great stuff, lots of good stuff. I would highly recommend both these. Blue Underground knocked it out of the park, but check them out. They're both classics, and they're both well worth your time.
Lock your doors, but you can't lock the madman out of your mind. Tear the life out of you.
Hey guys, we got a couple reviews we're going to do together. The first one is 2018's Death House. This movie has been coming out for the last 106 years, I think, but it finally got released. This was being like touted as The Expendables of Horror, and it was Gunnar Hansen's last movie. He actually wrote part of it in the original script years ago, but it tried to get as many horror icons, or basically convention circuit people, in one movie. So it has Kane Hodder, Tony Todd, Sid Haig, Bill Moseley, Barbara Crampton, Dee Wallace. The list is never ending. You know what I mean? It has everybody. The plot of this movie is insane.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to try to explain this plot?
I don't think you can explain the plot, because I don't remember any prior scene other than what was currently on the screen.
All right. The story is, it's a futuristic prison where it houses the most dangerous criminals around, is my understanding. They have these two agents who are supposed to go in the death house and go through some virtual reality thing, which is supposed to, I don't know, make them a better
employee,
agent. I'm not necessarily even sure why they're doing it, but these two are pretty ruthless, and they seem to have done something awful which has landed them in this death house, but I don't know if it's a reward or a punishment or what's going on with them. The bottom floor of this death house has the five evils, which is essentially, they're in hell. I understand that this death house goes to hell. This movie is a weird sci-fi kind of like gory weird movie that I don't necessarily know what's going on. And since everything is like virtual reality, there's lots of green screen effects. There's all sorts of strange things going on. And at first you're like, this is awful green screen. And then you're like, oh, it's kind of supposed to have everything be green screen. At first I was like, oh my God, this is, but then I was like, okay, they can get away with bad green screen, which was pretty good covering their tracks, if you know, because it has this weird sci-fi edge to it.
I would say that the second half of the movie holds up a lot better than the first half. In the first half, I'm like, they were jumping scene to scene. I'm like, I don't understand any of this relevance. I don't understand what's going on. Like, they like tried showing, like, setting up each character in, like, a small, like, 5-minute vignette, but it just wasn't really going anywhere, and their stories were too segmented for you to, like, weave anything together. So by, like, the 30-minute mark, you're like, okay, they're in a place, all right.
Objectively, it's a pretty bad movie, I think. But yeah, to be brutally honest, I was never bored.
Yeah, it's not boring.
it's not boring.
And it's fun.
It's kind of fun, even though it's ridiculous. And I think what hurts it is this movie was probably hyped up so much. People are like, oh, it's going to be... But when you get a lot of those names in there, everybody's going to be fighting for screen time, and it's just going to be essentially a bunch of cameos back to back to back, which gets old very fast. But it is fun seeing some of them. And to be honest, Kane Hodder does pretty good. Kane Hodder always, to me, was one of those guys that it's like every time he's in a movie, he's like, I've been a stuntman for so long that anybody sees me in an acting role, I think they're going to assume, oh, here comes a stuntman, he can't act. And then I think Kane Hodder always had his chip on his shoulder. So every time he comes in an acting performance, it's always really good, I always thought. I thought that, you know, in like the Hatchet movies, when he's not Victor Crowley, but I mean, he's good as Victor Crowley. But when he's a human, actually, in the movies, I think it's the best performance in those movies. So he always comes in and he always does a good job, and he actually is pretty good in this movie, I think. He's like an ex-con. Well, he's not an ex-con. He was an ex-agent that set the one lady up and had her do some killings for him. It's very weird. The weakest part of this movie is actually the two leads. Yeah. They're not good. They don't really have chemistry, and they're not very... It's just awful. And a lot of the... There's a scene where they're showering. It's just to get a bunch of, like, kind of skin in the movie. And the way that's edited, like, the audio stuff is bad. It's, like, ADR, and then there's huge gaps in between answers. It's just poorly done. And I think that this movie looks like it didn't have all the footage it needed to be completed. And I think that's probably what's going on, too. It's probably why it took so long to come out. Would you agree with that?
I mean, I don't know anything about the making of this movie.
But I
would agree with the shower scene was just really awkward.
Really awkward. And the five evils have a lot of familiar faces, like Vernon Wells, Bill Moseley, Michael Berryman, and two other people that I didn't recognize. One was, I guess, from The Walking Dead. So it's just like, I don't know. But Berryman doesn't get the talk at all, barely. He has like one line. And it's just like, really? And they have a scene with Sid Haig, and he doesn't stand up. And, you know, like, Sid Haig, you know, old guy, probably just like... I always made a joke about Steven Seagal just being lazy, hence why he wanted to sit down in most of his movies later on. Like, do I get to sit down? Like, yeah, it's like, I want to be a sniper. They're always sitting down. But, you know, Sid Haig's an old guy. And he did fine, but he looked pretty rough in it, you know.
It was the doctor that was following them around mostly. Is that Dee Wallace?
Yeah, Dee Wallace from
Cujo. She did pretty good.
Yeah, she did solid. Barbara Crampton does solid as well. There's this really weird scene where they're going into like these different layers, and one scene just seems like straight out of Hellraiser. They see like these mutated, like kind of like, I don't know what they are, but they're like, we no longer want to be free. And they're all like Skinless Frank and Julie's, basically.
That was like the highlight of the movie, I feel.
And that's by far the best part of the movie. It's like a pit of these like gross things, eating things. And it's actually really disturbing. And I wish the whole movie was like that. It would be a lot better.
Me too. It felt like something that you would watch on like Adult Swim, like right before we did like the... Because you know how Adult Swim does, like the cycle every hour, or, like, every, like, 2 hours, they, like, start over from, like, their airtime. It's, like, the very last thing they'd air, and then you get back to, like, watching Family Guy.
No, but to be brutally honest, it does feel like that Super Jail show.
It does. I remember, it's very Super Jail-ish.
And it is jailish. When I turned on Super Jail, I was like, what the hell is this? This doesn't make any sense. It was just, like, screaming and yelling and blood, and I was just like, this is not for me, Super Jail. And this is, like, the... movie version of Super Jail.
It's like if Super Jail and Metalocalypse had like a bastard child, this is what you would get if it was live action.
And it was on a budget, and they just filled it with a bunch of horror icons. I don't know if it's worth watching or not. if you like a lot of these people, I mean, Lloyd Kaufman's in it even too, of course. How are you going to have...
Lloyd Kaufman is pretty good.
He's funny in it. But I mean, it is what it is. It's like a convention circuit with all the faces in there. No Robert Englund, unfortunately, but, you know, probably is asking for too much money. They did manage to squeeze Gunnar Hansen in there. The cast and crew interviews are a bit strange. The two producers, it's just like, they're a strange duo. And one guy talked over the other guy the whole time, and it just was a weird interview, to be honest. But their hearts are in the right place. But it's just not a particularly great movie. I imagine that there was lots of stuff to juggle, and just so many characters and so many actors and so many... I imagine this movie had a lot of problems. But yeah, that is Death House, and it says dubbed by fans as being the Expendables of Horror. He didn't call it it. The guy on the cover didn't call it it, but it's a dubbed by fans, so. You good on this one?
I'm good.
The Death House, established in 1954 under the Eisenhower administration, serves as a federal maximum security prison, medical, psychological, and parapsychological research center.
Agent Novak. Meet your fellow graduate, Agent Toria Boone.
Welcome to Death House. Does it live up to what you study?
Ask me again in 12 hours. Some are dosed with just LSD, while others are subjected to electroshock, sensory deprivation, all to break down the subject's personality.
They've got some surprises waiting for you and your girl here.
Our goal is to eradicate evil.
I will fuck you in hell.
Did Sieg ever mention Death House to you? Ever any talk of the five evils?
I know this house is insane. And I know that you have to be careful.
Don't you have something special lined up to kill everybody inside this hellhole?
Tell me you're both armed.
What about the five evils?
I know everything, Novak.
Red Maid!
We gotta find a way up.
I am immortal.
We need to get out of here.
I will follow you to hell. The way out is not that way. It's down to them. With me.
We forgot to close the elevator shaft.
All right, the next one is from Mill Creek Entertainment, and it's one of these like retro looking VHS Blu-ray deals, and it is Who's Harry Crumb, the John Candy vehicle from 1989, directed by Paul Flattery. I must say that I grew up watching this movie. This was one of my favorite movies as a kid. I loved it all the time. This Armed and Dangerous, you know, Great Outdoors, I used to watch all the time. I love John Candy, was a big John Candy fan growing up. And when I was a little kid, I even kept his newspaper clippings when he died. And I was only like six. So, you know, I loved John Candy. But Who's Harry Crumb? It's a light comedy about a private eye who comes from a great family, a long lineage of great private eyes. And he, you kind of find out he had a head injury when he was young. And he's not on their caliber. He's like a savant. Savant?
Savant,
yeah. Like, he's good at some things, but he's complete moron at other things. And he's completely oblivious. So he has to solve this kidnapping case with a bunch of rich people and bunch of other people in there. So, you got anything to say about this one?
I like that. I've never seen it before. It felt like a Chris Farley movie.
Yeah, definitely Chris Farley channeled John Candy in a lot of stuff. Especially, like, this is like the John Candy, Who's Harry Crumb and Beverly Hills Ninja would be a great... They're the same freaking movie, yeah. Almost. But, I know people don't love Beverly Hills Ninja. I do. This one is very lighthearted. It's very stupid. It's very slapsticky. I love that kind of stuff. The funny thing nowadays is this is about as light as you could get for a comedy. But by today's standards, like, let's just say, I can't wait to listen to the 80s all over guys when they get to it in 89. They'd be like, God bless John Candy, we love him, but this movie is xenophobic, it's racist, it's homophobic, it's this transphobic. Watch. And because at times, I'm sorry, I grew up with that kind of humor and I didn't know any better, so it's like embedded in my head to find funny when John Candy like becomes these weird characters that he has no business becoming. Like this Turkish guy. And he goes in and he has this chest there, and he goes in and he says his name. He's like, I am so-and-so. He's like, the guy's like, do you know how to spell that? He's like, I don't know. Try it with a D. And it's just, it's a beautiful moment. And he plays an Arab guy. And at the end, there's some cross-dressing, which is like the third time he's cross-dressed. If you take Armed and Dangerous and Nothing But Trouble in films. So it should have been the second time, though. But he did it three times, as far as I know. But it's just a movie that I guess it's, by today's standards, politically incorrect, but by 1989 standards, is a family light, zany slapstick comedy that has a great cast in here, to be honest, as far as like the side players. Tim Thomerson plays a doofus. He's good at playing a doofus. But Jeffrey Jones steals the show as this, like, the guy, who, the owner of the private eye company that John Candy works for, that is father used to own, and he is just a slime ball. He's playing the kind of character he's really good at, a slime in a suit. Mm-hmm. Any particular gags that you thought were really funny?
I like the air conditioning scene. Anytime that he hands somebody photographs is just like, why don't you look at them first, you idiot?
I love his puns and stuff. Like when he's talking, he just doesn't know. But I love the chemistry that he has with the police detective that he can't stand. They also were in the movie Nothing But Trouble together. I can't think of the actress's name. But there's a great footsie gag scene in here where everybody's playing footsie at the table. And it all gets confusing. And Jeffrey Jones goes to get footsie to her. And that part is wonderful. It's just so funny and stupid, and Barry Corbin's in it, and I can't help but think that if Warren Oates wasn't dead, he would have been that role. This would have been like the third time he would have worked with John Candy, but Barry Corbin is definitely like a Warren Oates type. Not as good, I don't think, but still good. I mean, in Critters 2 and a bunch of stuff, but I just can't. If you really like this kind of stuff, if you like the slapsticky stuff, I would check it out. It's lowbrow humor. It's not for aristocrats. It's just John Candy bubbling through and somehow managing to save the day like any other, you know, heavyset comedian would do.
Well, to be fair, yeah, the physical comedy of a slapstick, yeah, it's lowbrow, but like the spoken stuff, it's pretty good.
It's
like,
witty. It's pretty
witty. It's very witty, and I enjoy, because it's never like the just the vocal comedy is just like put out there. They never like focus on it, you know, and it just, it makes me laugh. I don't know, it's
a lot of jokes, and if you don't like one, the next one might get you
right.
What about when he's standing in front under the sprinkler?
Yeah.
And he looks up like it's raining, but his crotch is getting wet.
You know, just the whole ending part with the club, you know, and like they never say is it this kind of club or that kind of club, but if you just put two and two together, you're like, okay, that was a pretty funny.
Oh, the bottoms up joke.
The bottoms up joke.
Oh,
yeah.
We have a murder.
No, I've never been there.
We have a murder at the bottoms up. Oh, I'm familiar with that club. You've been here? I've never been there. Just like, see, that's like the kind of humor that would upset people now. It's not, to me, it's not what they're saying, it's how they're saying it. And the tone is not a hateful thing in here. It's a goofy, silly movie. And I love John Candy, always love John Candy. He's very rarely makes a movie that I can't watch. But I was trying to think of the one verbal joke where he's like, you are just a fountain of youth, fountain of knowledge, Mr. Crumb. And he says something like, I've said something I can't remember because he misinterprets what he says.
Right.
But it's pretty funny. It's good stuff. I think most people would enjoy it if you like John Candy. It's similar to Armed and Dangerous, just a lot stupider, a lot dumber.
I've never seen that.
Armed and Dangerous is rated R, I think. It's a Mark Lester. Maybe it's PG-13. There's some action. People get shot. It's a little bit more, you know, I guess, risque in the career of John Candy. But The disc is completely bare bones, no subtitles, no trailer, but hey, it's pretty cheap. I think these are Walmart exclusives at the time being, but you can pick it up on walmart.com or in person, I believe, or on Amazon if you want to pay double. But, you know, a lot of people are like, they don't like that they lack features, but sometimes it's better buying a movie for under $10 and getting a movie you love in HD that looks good. Then I wish they had subtitles though. Then instead of paying $39.99 for some interviews you may possibly not want to see. I mean, so I do appreciate the deluxe editions, but I don't need every movie in a deluxe edition. And I don't need Who's Harry Crumb in a deluxe edition. This is perfectly satisfactory and I enjoy it. So
a woman in danger, a fortune in ransom.
I don't care what they want, I'll pay anything.
A mystery in the making.
You don't know anything about this kidnapping, do you?
There's only one man tough enough to intimidate the suspect, smart enough to uncover the clues, brave enough to catch the kidnappers.
Who is that?
Harry Crumb. That's right, the Harry Crumb.
He's the last in a long line of great detectives.
My reputation precedes me. Otherwise, I'd be late for all my appointments.
He's a master of disguise.
I am Bejou Dilioche.
Could you spell that, please?
I don't think so. Try it with a D.
His mind is like a steel trap.
You find that crazy typewriter, and you'll have your kidnappers.
No wonder they took her. Just look at her. She's perfect.
Perfect? Yeah, I don't know. I mean, look at the size of her head. She must be enormous.
You get paid for this?
Usually, yeah.
Are you a fly fisherman?
Fishing is my life.
Oh. Who's Harry Crumb? He's the best at tracking down the worst.
Nimble yet clumsy. Cunning yet naive.
He's a man's man, loved by women. He's coming on strong. He's coming through. And he's coming to a theater near you.
Harry Crumb.
John Candy.
Looks like this one get a little rough.
Who's Harry Crumb?
Okay, guys, the next one here is from the late 80s. It is Split. You know, I never heard about this. It's from Verboten Films, and this was sent to me to review, and I was interested in checking this one out. It was a cult film. It was supposed to be strange cinema, midnight cinema, that kind of deal. And this is one of these movies that is definitely going to divide the audience. As all cult movies would divide the audience, I think, but you have to see it for yourself. So no matter what I say, if it sounds like something you'd be interested in, definitely check it out. First and foremost, I didn't particularly care for this one. It's a movie that has a lot of allegory and a lot of messages, and the message, mostly a positive one for sure. It's about this homeless derelict who's living in a futuristic society, or maybe not even that futuristic, but we have this agency, this secret agency that watches people that could disrupt the society as they know it. And if they do that, they could have free thought and they could break away and not have any productivity. And these people behind the scenes would lose their influence and whatnot. The agency is run by this man who's aging, who wants to live forever, who's slowly turning into a machine. Darth Vader, anyone? But regardless, this homeless man is evading them by changing personalities. And when he changes personalities, he ends up mingling with other groups of people and kind of influencing them. And he has this strange plastic thing that he says is a drug that changes the way people will think, and it will free their minds and eventually cause, uprising. People will stop caring about the things they care about. And that's the basic plot of the movie. It's very strange. The lead performance is played in a humorous kind of comedic way. And it has this like allegory, all this allegory and messages, but it has this weird zany tone that I never think truly mixes, and it makes for a very tedious watch. In particular, the extended cut of the film does, which is 20 minutes longer than the theatrical cut. But my favorite parts of the film involve the end, a lot of the visuals in the ending when the guy's turning into a machine and he's just this great, I don't want to say it's a mirror trick, but this pool trick where he reaches into a pool to intercept the hero when he comes out of a pond. That stuff's great. It looks great. I like that it takes place in Santa Cruz. I like that they make fun of the art crowd in the art gallery scene where they make fun of these pretentious free thinkers and whatnot, making fun of people's art, and they don't make art themselves. You know, I mean, that's a statement probably on that. This is the director's first film, and it kind of shows when I'm going into those aspects. But my favorite part of the whole movie is the character of Susan. She starts off as kind of a throwaway character, a waitress in the beginning, and you think that's where it's going to end, but she ends up coming in as some sort of love interest, and she's neurotic and weird, and she kind of, I guess in a way, is supposed to be the audience way, because they into the movie where she kind of does strange things and is into weird things, and her character has the best arc. I think she's the most interesting. The lead performance is a strange, which, like I said, he's jumping back and forth between all these different characters, and it's a weird movie and a strange film as well. And like I said, it will work for some people. Some people love all this stuff and they'll dig it. For me, I just thought it was just, I never thought that the tone was there for me. I don't think those things mixed very well, and it just becomes kind of a unique one-of-a-kind film that if people are interested in seeing, they should see. But there's two cuts of it, the extended cut, the theatrical cut, and two cast and crew interviews, one with the actress who played Susan and another with one of the other actors in the movie. And they talk about a little bit of the making of the movie and how it's prevalent, how it resonates today. I shouldn't say prevalent today, but resonates today. It is a nice release. It looks pretty good. It's in full screen. There's lots of, I guess at the time, state-of-the-art computer effects. So that's pretty neat. And like I said, there's some cool visuals in the movie, and I like seeing Santa Cruz in the late 80s was also nice. And the difference between New York, the last movie, Maniac, and Santa Cruz is a major one. But kind of unique and different and weird, and I'm not necessarily sure how the agency's software and technology works, but hey, it's a movie after all.
Hey, everybody, quiet. Vinny, put the logo up there. We gotta start the movie. Ah, that's beautiful. Start the music.
Once every generation, there comes a film that changes life as we know it. You've heard of Potemkin. You've seen Dr. Strangelove. Well, now there's Split. Meet Starker, Deadbeat, Drifter, Sweet and Low Addict, Starker, Visionary, Man with a Dream, Starker. Intellectual, a man of a thousand faces, each one a different window through which his message shines. A message so intellectually sweeping that few understand it.
What you say may be incomprehensible and boring, but that doesn't make it true.
The one man entrusted to hold the distilled essence of life.
Today is here. In my package.
Is also a master of disguise.
What I'm holding in my hand is a drug. A mutant biological organism has a very specific effect on the neurotransmitters of the human brain.
You know what it looks like? It looks like one of those urinal tablets. You know, they put them in urinals, they smell like raspberries.
We are in danger. You've got to believe me.
There is a shadowy high-tech intelligence network that watches our every move. We know it exists, but we choose to ignore it. This organization is the first to recognize who Starker is and to realize the earth-shaking importance of his vital mission.
You think this guy Starker is nothing? You're right.
This is the high priest of the new religion, science. But the technology that empowers him also enslaves him.
It's fabulous.
Well, listen! This is my life you're playing with! My life! And this is ugly.
Starker, the one hope in a technology-choked world that's dying for change.
No, it's gotta change. Lunatics like you shoving your fluoridation formula down our throats and draining us in your acid flashbacks!
Finding.
again.
Okay, guys, the next one here is from RLJ Entertainment, or Image Films, and it's directed by Rebecca McKendry and David Ian McKendry. They're a husband-wife filmmaking team. I know, it's called All the Creatures We're Stirring. It's a Christmas anthology. I'm familiar with Rebecca McKendry, obviously. I dropped Ella Kane's name earlier. I don't know her personally, but I love her podcast, Shockwaves, and she seems like a genuinely great person. So saying that, maybe I'm a little biased, but she directed this movie, like I said, with her husband, and it's a Christmas anthology. Five shorts. One is kind of a Christmas present exchange that turns into a Saw-like scenario. Another one is involving a creature and somebody being locked out of their car. Another one is a Scrooge-style story. We have a revengeful deer, and then we have an alien invasion. Those are the stories all told in the wraparound. There's some familiar faces in here. Graham Skipper, Amanda Fuller. There's a lot of people you'd recognize if you've been watching horror films or independent films for the last 10 years. And a lot of them are welcome faces. And there's no real bad links of acting in this movie. I'll say this movie looks very crisp. It looked very good. The lighting was perfect. It had enough perfect Christmas lighting. It never got to that, like you're expecting it to be completely like maybe a little bit too blue for Christmas. But I thought the lighting was dead on. I thought it look crisp. And the stories vary with an anthology. I love anthologies, so, you know, I love stuff like that. So I was into it. And, you know, some of the stories are stronger than the others. The first one, which is a great concept, Saw, kind of the way of a Christmas exchange, is really fun. The motives of the people towards the end or their actions, I always kind of, when it comes to this, you're going to have extreme characters, and sometimes they seem unrealistic. But at times, it's fun. It's pretty good. The gore worked well in that one. Also, the second story, I think, is the best story of the bunch, and I like the acting in this one, and I like the more I talk about it, that's the problem with anthologies. When you start to review anthologies, you start running down all the stories, and by then, that's so much you talked about, you don't even explain too much about the filmmaking skills. But regardless, I think this is the strongest one, and I want to spoil it the least. But I thought it had good mythology, I thought it was creepy, and I thought it was the strongest, like I said. And probably the best acted. Maybe. All of it's well acted, I think. The next story involves it was a Scrooge-style story, which I really enjoyed that they made a fake Scrooge movie for the character to watch on TV. This is about, you know, a jerk. It's a more modern jerk on Christmas. He hates Christmas, and he finally sees the light. But it has some horror twist to it as well. The next story, I think, is probably the weakest because it's the shortest, and I like the concept. It's kind of like a throwaway gag, and it's very short, but it's pretty funny. It's about a guy who hits a reindeer on the way home on Christmas, and of course, you know, he doesn't know that something was watching him off to the side in the woods. And the way they do it is all point of view of some antlers, essentially. It's a cute idea. It never really comes out fully formed for me. I would have liked longer. I would have liked to see the reindeer itself, but I can't really complain because it is an anthology and it was low budget. But it's funny. It's just probably one of the weaker ones in here. And the last story is probably one of the funnier ones, and I think it has one of the better performances in here from the lead female and the lead male. I thought they did tremendous. It's about, and it takes a turn on you. You think it's going to be one thing and it becomes another thing, and the way that it completely changes formats is also very fun. And it has some good gags and there's some good jokes. I would recommend it. The wraparound is pretty cool, pretty different. And not necessarily different. It's pretty cool though. I mean, all these wraparounds are the same. They find a VHS, they go to a movie theater. Essentially, that's this. There's two people that had nothing to do on Christmas Eve, so they meet up and they go to this show, and it's this avant-garde, or I guess you'd say, or experimental, like kind of stage show where these people are pantomiming and acting out. And they seem miserable. Graham Skipper is one of them. It's pretty funny. But all around, it's a solid anthology. It's fun. It has a good Christmas themes and elements in here that make it, you know, it's not just, hey, we threw a Christmas tree in the background. They do involve a Christmas feel. They all do have that thing going for them. I think they all work to some extent. I think that they all look good. I like the lighting on it. I like the humor in it. It's not too humorous. All the humor works. It never breaks its tone. It is silly to serious at times. And I think it all around is really cool and fun, and I would recommend checking it out. It's going to be out on VOD and DVD December 4th. 4 days after you'll see this, I think, or 4 days before you'll see this, but that's All the Creatures We're Stirring.
Merry Christmas!
Hey. I got everything.
Is dinner ready yet?
Merry Christmas!
Bells on bobtails ring.
Oh, no.
you all die.
All load on Christmas, Chet.
You sure you don't want to wait in the van?
You know what? I should wait by my car.
You'll be visited by three ghosts. Pure poppycock.
Someone will open a gift, and the next person can steal someone else's already open gift. This is gonna be so much fun!
Hey guys, come check out this star.
We really should have fired you.
Hey Santa, teach me to dance.
Well, anything's better than being alone on Christmas Eve.
Teach me to dance. Hey Santa, teach me to dance.
Okay, guys, we're gonna hop into some Patreon picks. I did I have like 10 or 12 to do this month, but I hopped in for December Patreon picks. I got 4 for you. We got Curse of the Blue Lights. This one was picked by Jonathan Wilhelm. This one made in 1988. This is a Code Red DVD. I've always wanted to see this movie. I never watched it. I'm a sucker for monsters. I'm a sucker for zombies. This movie is ridiculous. We have a group of kids who end up spotting some weird golem or some stone man. The Muldoon Man is actually what he is in the movie, you find out. They find this Muldoon Man, and they find this medallion and take it. And they're coming back to take the Muldoon Man, and he's gone. And they realize that there's these kind of weird ghouls that live in the cemetery, led by this hefty fellow on the cover. And he has these two helpers, and these little monsters or whatever they are, these ghouls, are trying to resurrect the Muldoon Man so he will take over the world and bring in an era of darkness or whatever the hell they're trying to do. I don't know. I couldn't understand what they were saying because they had these giant teeth in and they'd be like, suckling suckatash. So you guys know when they have these low budget movies or any movies in general where they have big monster teeth in and they just can't speak properly. Brotherhood of Blood comes to mind with Sid Haig and Ken Foree. But that's definitely a problem here. But what really impressed me with this movie is the sets. This is like, you watch the behind the scenes pictures and everything like that. The acting in here is not good. It's not great. It's pretty shaky acting. It's a pretty cheesy movie in all general. And the plot is fun. But the sets are actually really good. They're thick with atmosphere. It's in a cemetery. There's nice fog. The special effects are pretty decent. There's some gore scenes here and there. I like the small town atmosphere of the movie. But its acting is sloppy. The story is a little sloppy. And there's lots of laugh out loud moments in the movie. At the end, there's a horde of zombies, which kind of made me happy. I was like, wow, this is pretty cool. We got a horde of zombies coming in here. The Muldoon Man is hilarious. He actually does get to come to life. The lead baddie is really cheesy. This becomes like a fantasy movie at times where the kids end up picking up swords and fighting swords with them. And this like almost like kid style music comes in. This reminds me of something that was like a more low budget Graveyard Disturbance by Lamberto Bava. But it's so silly that it's just like, this should have been a kid's movie. Cut out the gore. This is a kid's movie. It's one of those deals where, who is this made for? Like, a lot of those Full Moon movies, like, this plot's too stupid. These monsters are too silly. And everything screams kid's movie, but then there's gore and nudity in it. I think they're aimed at kids, but the general audience not renting them is an adult. So, I don't know. But this definitely feels like it would be, like, that kind of style thing. Almost sometimes like a Full Moon movie. It is kind of enjoyable. It's not perfect or anything like that. It's cheap. It's low budget. But there's moments to enjoy. There's some fun special effects. There's lots of zombies in here at the end. Some look awful. Some are just kind of like guys in masks doing this. Like just grab your uncle and like be a monster. And he's like, eh. It's fun. You'll have a good time. Watch it with some friends. Don't watch it alone like I did. Don't make that mistake. You won't enjoy it that much like me. But I had some laughs with it, and I'm glad I seen it. I wish I would have saw it when I was 8 years old. I'd probably have some fondness for it. The disc does have a commentary on here. This guy did a few movies before this, which I think are really hard to find. I couldn't really find much about them. But Curse of the Blue Lights. It is enjoyable, although it is pretty stupid. Check it out.
So what
What is it this time, Fox? Jaywalking?
Oh my God!
This creature transformed her life. What a good companion he will be for me. For his name of Bob, I will abide.
Okay, guys, the next Patreon pick is from Giggity Wing. It is 1994's Funny Man with Christopher Lee. This is a British film. This is another one that I've been meaning to watch for years. Okay, let me get this off my chest. This is a cartoon. This is a live-action cartoon. This movie is crazy. Has this character called the Funny Man, this kind of rich jerk-off, wins in a card bet against Christopher Lee, of course, and he inherits this house. In the house is the Funny Man, this weird kind of zany jester that kills people like a la cartoons and strange Freddy Krueger worlds. I don't know what's going on. This is a very weird movie. The lead guy's brother's on his way to visit him. He picks up a bunch of people who are hitchhiking. One who is Velma from, I don't know the joke there, she's just dressed as Velma, acts like Velma, name is Velma, and they end up going to the house, and they all start getting picked off by the Funny Man. This movie is definitely an acquired taste. There is some weird effects, if I remember correctly. There's the Funny Man takes on a lot of personas. He breaks the fourth wall, looks right out of the camera, and says some weird things, some jokes. This feels like a Wild E. Coyote cartoon, to be honest, a Roadrunner cartoon. It feels just like that. There's some really cool miniatures that I really enjoyed in the movie. Christopher Lee has a lot of weird quotes in here, like Lewis Carroll quotes. I don't know what they are, Bible quotes, all sorts of quotes. But I guarantee Christopher Lee shot for a day. There's the tarot cards thing, and every time I see tarot cards, I roll my eyes, even though whether it's Anthropophagus or this. The only time I don't hate it is Dead Alive. because I don't know, it feels right in that movie. This one, I'm just like, here we go, the tarot cards. It's weird when they reveal the killer's face for the first time. They do it nonchalantly, which I thought was strange. And I remember somebody being killed in here with some, white on blood on white cloth. This looks really great. I do like that the funny man ends up becoming like a cowboy at times, at one time in the movie. But it's just a weird, crazy movie. It has its blood. It has its crazy nonsense. It's a unique movie. I don't think I particularly liked it. It's a fever dream live action cartoon. The performance is pretty solid in here. There's some weird nudity in here where he actually turns into things. It's like a cracked out Freddy Krueger, I guess you could say. If you like Freddy's Dead and you wanted more of that, then you might like this one. I felt like this picture quality on this one, somebody just took the brightness and they're like, hey, and turned it up on my TV and we're like, we remastered it. We turned it really bright. I don't know why it was like that, but it was very strange. This was based on a short, original short called The Funny Man, which I didn't get a chance to see. And the disc has a bunch of features on here. I believe there is a UK Blu-ray from 101 Films or 88 Films, one of those guys. But it's a weird movie, and it's definitely, check out the trailer. It's something that you'll have to make up your mind to check out or not. Weird, weird stuff, but it has its moments. The person I was watching with had dozed off, and they were sick, and they kept waking up, and they're like, "What?" And the next day, I saw them, and they're like, "What was that? What was going on? Like, was that a nightmare?" That's pretty much The Funny Man. It's weird.
From the heavens, reaching down through time and space towards the ground, the bitten hand of fate unlocks the secrets of Pandora's box. Welcome, fun lovers, to the nightclubs of hell. Get into this, big boy. Game of chance begins. Who could know or guess the rules? Adrift upon the ship of fools.
Shot it.
You're a funny man. I've met funnier. And so will you.
Take a one-way ride to rock and roll.
Okay, the next Patreon pick is from my friend Brandon Salkill, and it is Altered 2006 by Eduardo Sanchez, the director of The Blair Witch Project. I'd never seen this. Again, another good pick for me to watch because I hadn't seen it. Altered. This movie's really cool. It opens up amazingly. And that the fun thing is the three characters it opens up with this are these, I guess, rednecks, hillbillies, you know, backwoods kind of guys. And they're trying to capture something. You realize what it is very quickly, an alien. And they bring it back to another guy. And you start to realize these guys' backstories. These four guys, along with another guys, were once abducted by these aliens. And they were messed with. And a couple of them were really hurt. And one never came back. So that's the setup of the movie. What I'll say off the bat, the three characters in the opening have great chemistry. And the character Cody, what is his name? I can't think of it. There's Cody, Otis, and there's another one. I can't, but the skinny guy who is a complete jerk throughout the entire movie. At first, you're thinking, why is he such a jerk? And you learn as the movie goes on between him and the lead. And I thought his performance was one of the strongest in the movie. A couple of these, Duke, one of the strongest characters in the movie. And I loved, his name's not Duke, but the other character's name's Duke. One of the strongest characters in the movie. Because I remember I was watching that and I was like, well, we have Duke. And there was another character in here that had kind of a country Western name. And I was like, I bet this guy's a big Western fan. Nobody names somebody the Duke and doesn't think of John Wayne. But yeah, so we have these country boys who have this alien hostage, and they realize that they're going to try to, one of the guys wants to torture it to get revenge for the guy that didn't come back. The other guy wants to let it go because he understands that these things have power. And they also have a weird telekinetic thing where they can get in and start to control people, mind control through their eyes. I will say that the practical effects on this creature are amazing. It's one of the best creatures I've seen in a very long time. And it strikes me weird. When I saw Blair Witch, I didn't like it, but I was also like 12 years old. I have never seen it since, which is crazy. And it's weird that like the Blair Witch made like $100 million. And yet Eduardo Sanchez didn't seem to be able to get any money. It's like, this guy made you a buttload of money. What does he have to do? Sell his firstborn to get a decent budget? I imagine this one wasn't a huge budget either. I don't know, but it was really good. And it was a isolated film. And I usually like those. You don't think Night of the Living Dead, From Dusk Till Dawn, The Thing, you're trapped in a certain area. I like those kind of movies. As long as you have good dialogue and good characters. And for the most part, three of these characters I thought were tremendous. Actually, four. The sheriff ends up showing up in that kind of way. And he's a great character. He's played by a character actor. What is it? James Gammon or Gannon? James Gammon, I think it is. He pops up in, Natural Born Killers. He's the guy who gets his finger cut off in the cafe in the opening. But he's tremendous in this movie. My biggest complaint about the movie is, although the two leads, really, the main guy and his love interest, I don't care for. I mean, they're not horrible. They're fine actors, I guess. But they're the weakest links in the whole movie for me. But the special effects are great. The practical stuff looks amazing. And I like, there's great moments of humor. Like I'm using humor instead of comedy because when I was listening to The Exploding Heads, Dave Z said something that was really smart. He said, you know, the movie has good humor, not comedy, because this movie is not a comedy. And, you know, some people will say they don't like comedy in their horror, and almost all movies have humor, and they should have humor. Most movies should have some sort of humor, even if it's very, very dark humor, and a lot of people don't pick up on it. But almost every movie has some sort of humor, and this movie's humor is really good. The interactions with the characters talk to each other, you can tell they're old friends, they have great chemistry, it works really well, and I actually enjoyed every character in the movie for the most part, like I said, although the two were the weakest when they were the main ones. But I loved four of these characters tremendously, and I liked their chemistry. And I liked the backstory, and I liked what they went into. Some stuff gets aggravating with what some of the characters do, but besides that, it was a really good movie, and it has good effects, good story, and the opening is actually tremendous. On the disc, there are some deleted scenes, which were also cool seeing. Some of them I'm glad they deleted, but I would recommend checking out Altered. Good stuff, and I probably should check out his other movie. I didn't care for Exist, believe it or not, but I really like this one from Eduardo Sanchez.
There's nothing out there, baby.
Said you were holding a hostage. An extraterrestrial one.
What the hell did you boys do?
It's loose, ain't it?
Just do what he says and secure the door.
Please, no. Please, no. Please don't.
Help me.
Okay, the next Patreon pick I watched on Amazon Prime streaming. It is from the 22 Shots Moods and Horror pick this one. It was Jeremy who picked this one, and it is You Are Not Alone. I watched this one on there, and right off the bat, I was like, what's going on here? And I realized it's point of view. Not found footage, point of view from the main character. And throughout this movie, once in a great while, you'll see her close her eyes, which distracted me because then I started thinking, why isn't she blinking? And then it distracted me to think, well, maybe if they incorporated a blink every 5 seconds, it would be very distracting, and maybe the person, the human blinking, doesn't register that they're blinking, so why make the point of view blink? I don't know why I was thinking that, but I did think that. This movie opens up with this, I think it's a real police phone call about a woman being attacked and murdered, which is one of the disturbing things about it. I think it is real, and if it's not real, they did a tremendous job recreating it. But it opens up with this woman calling the police about somebody else at her house, and she gets murdered. It's all audio. Really freaky stuff. And then it goes into what you think is just a typical story about a college kid coming back and meeting with her friends and meeting with her mom and building of character development with her friends. But in the background, there's, you know, newspaper clippings and news stories and people talking about this killer going around and, you know, picking people off. The funny thing is, the first half of this movie is not a horror movie, actually. It's just like this, you know, character development. And I actually prefer this part. I preferred it was in the 4th of July. I thought that was cool. So you have fireworks going off everywhere to kind of cause distraction and chaos. But I like the interactions between all the characters. But when it turns into a horror movie, for me, it loses some steam. It kind of falls a little short, to be honest. I don't particularly care for the killer. I don't like the killer's performance. I don't like the killer's at all in general. He's kind of generic. He's just there, and I just, not intimidating. But I like the lead actress, even though it's her point of view, and I like her friends. I think they did a pretty good job. The ending is all right as well, but those are the weak points to me. It's definitely a gimmick movie, and it has the point of view stuff, and that's pretty much it. But I did like when they have these scenes when they're supposed to be out drinking and partying, driving in the back of a truck, going through town, and it reminded me of, you know, when I used to be in high school and go out and, you know, get drunk in high school and be in the back of trucks and stuff, and just that summer kind of quality in the air and that small town feel, you know, it does really well at recreating a lot of that stuff in the first half and feeling real. But the second half, the horror elements aren't particularly as well done for me, as probably because the killer is not intimidating and he's kind of just there. I don't really care for him. I think that the movie should have had more kills in it, to be honest, too. I know it's not really that kind of movie, but all in all, it's a decent watch. I didn't think it was particularly great or anything, and I thought the first half set it up to, I was more interested in just watching a drama with these characters at that point. And that's good filmmaking, except that the second part was turned into, you know, kind of a run-of-the-mill, let's just make it a point-of-view horror movie, suspense thing, and I don't think it works as well. It's not horrible, but, you know, it's kind of in the mixed bag for me.
6 people have been murdered in little more than a week in Bureau Area 23 to confirm the identity of the killer, but have released this police sketch.
Love you so much.
I love you too.
Yeah, Mom and Dad went up to the cabin this weekend.
Oh, really? So they're not even here? How are things, Miss Nat? Things are okay. You know, school's over, and now I sort of don't know what to do with myself.
What are you doing?
I'm back for the 4th, just for like a couple days.
Oh, so you're not back here for good?
I repeat, we have 2 children missing, ages 6.
There's this guy, like, he was outside our house.
Okay, guys, I haven't done one of these suckers in a while, and it is the Weekly Western.
Let's go. Why not?
Fill your hand, you son of a bitch!
Say when.
Culpeper Cattle Company. This was made in, I believe, 1972. And, you know, it's the heart of American filmmaking, to be honest. Yeah, this is a Western, and it's a revisionist Western. It follows the story of a young boy who is obsessed with a cowboy way of life, and he ends up running off and joining this cattle company to move some cattle across country. And he actually basically sees the reality of it. Within the first couple days on the job, somebody is trampled in a stampede, and he gets his horse stolen. He sees witnesses a violent shootout, and it just gets crazier and crazier from there. You know why I realize I love Westerns? I've always felt that it was a part of our, you know, American like history, and I'm just interested in it and that idea that the way of life is so hard. But another major thing is the cast. These movies always have great cast, great character actors, and this one is no different. We have Matt Clark, Royal Dano, Lewis Skew, Jeffrey Lewis, and there's Bo Hopkins. Right there is a tremendous cast, and some other familiar faces. And I find this one particularly interesting, to be honest, because we have, I believe, 1971, Philip Kaufman's Great Northfield, Minnesota Raid, which had Royal Dano, Matt Clark, and the character who plays Missoula in it, who in this one, he plays Missoula in the Culpeper. All in that movie, they end up in the Culpeper Cattle Company. And then Sam Peckinpah tells this director that he liked this movie quite a bit. And he goes ahead and uses Lewis Skew, who else pops up? Matt Clark, and there's another guy in here Pat Garrett and Billy the Kid. So he uses three of the actors from the Culpeper Cattle Company from this, and this director had three actors from the Great Northfield, Minnesota Raid. I find that interesting. I find that unique, but the basic plot, like I said, as it goes on, the movie kind of changes a little bit here, a tune. It changes like tones when it shifts kind of the second half when they lose some of their ranchers or the ranch hands, or the cowboys, I guess is more appropriate. Culpeper sends away Gary, the Gary Grimes, the lead guy in this movie, who's the kid, who's basically, you know, the whole story revolves around him, to pick up these other guys, and you don't know who they are. He says, go pick up so-and-so and have him see if he's got any more guy, three good men with him. And these four end up being these outlaws, and they are, you know, a part of Culpeper's old way of life. And these guys come in, and there's just a streak of violence. You wouldn't think a movie about, you know, moving cattle would be so violent, but it becomes that. And it definitely is very, it feels much like a Peckinpah movie, you know, inspired kind of like by the the Wild Bunch. Jeffrey Lewis in this movie is tremendous. He's crazy. He's got his crazy eyes, and it was his first movie, I believe, one of his first roles. He's tremendous in it. Matt Clark is really good in this movie as well. He's always bullshit and always lying. But the four criminals in here, you know, Lewis Skew, very silent with the knives, and then it became like a trope in these westerns. Ever since Magnificent Seven with James Colburn with his knives, we have Lewis Skew with his knives. Then we have Lou Diamond Phillips as Chavez. Is it Chavez? Yeah, with his knives in the Young Guns movies. So we have this theme with knives and carried on to the Western movies forever. But Lewis Skew, Bo Hopkins, the guy who plays Missoula from Great Northfield, and Jeffrey Lewis are these like crazy criminals. And there's a really intense scene where there's a great shootout in this crowded saloon. Not crowded, but it's crowded because there's such small area and there's a lot of people in there. But pretty crowded area. And the end of this movie is tremendous. And it makes a statement about, you know, religious figures just manipulating people and not having any real spine. But it's a good movie, and the ending packs a powerful punch, and it lets this kid, it doesn't hold like the Western in this highlight, like, oh, it's such a wonderful, you know, great thing, and cattle, it's heroic, and it shows it in like this dark light, like almost immediately his horse is stolen, falls off the horse, his horse is stolen, people are killed, and then he becomes like this, he was like, oh, I want to stand up for something, and realizes a lot of this is bullshit, and his actions had, you know, severe consequences. And it's a great Western. It's one of the better ones I've seen in a long time. It's in the heart of, you know, great American filmmaking, 72. And it has a tremendous cast. And it's a really, really cool movie, which I had heard about before. I know that Joe Rubin talked about it when I interviewed him. And he mentioned how much he liked it. And I was just surprised how good of a cast it had and how well acted it was. And, you know, it's kind of this story of this little kid on a series of misadventures, coming of age, realizing that everything that he idolized was complete horseshit. Pun intended there with the horseshit. But great movie, really good. On here has a commentary of Bo Hopkins and a film historian, which is really, I listened to some of that. That was cool. And it also has an interview with the director. He talks about how he got started and how he talked to Sam Peckinpah, like this one, and how originally who was going to be the guy in here? Gregory Peck was going to be the lead, and the producer, one of the producers, screwed it up, or the guy who was going to produce it screwed it up. But that's also interesting and stuff. This guy did a bunch of other movies afterwards. So yeah, the Culpepper Cattle Company. I'd really recommend it if you like Westerns. This is it's not a region-free disc, but it is in the UK, and it's not too expensive.
I'll always remember the summer of 1866. That was the most important year of my life. That year I got my first real job, and I couldn't wait to break loose.
I'm with you, Mr. Culpepper.
Why?
Because I want to be a cowboy.
Well, that's one hell of an ambition, boy.
Yeah! I've never been up north before.
Where do we get to the desert?
I met a lot of new folks that summer, and it changed my whole way of thinking. That's the old lady. The boys used to say you could get better grub in jail.
How do you know what to put in there?
I don't.
There's Luke, Russ, Missoula, and Dixie Brick. Russ was kind of crazy.
Stand behind me, kid.
The Canyon Gang. One thing I learned from them, you can't trust anybody.
Mr. Culpepper, I'm sorry. I didn't mean nothing.
You just cost me a good man, boy.
Just drop your gun belts on the floor. Because all I gotta do is spit.
Mr. Thornton Pierce. He owned all the land between here and Fort Lewis.
Now get your horses and walk them out of town. Skit, boy!
And you too, brother!
Brother Nathaniel. He didn't fight.
Get off my land!
But he wouldn't run.
God's land.
My land!
God's land.
You're a squatter. Around here we shoot squatters.
These people, they need some kind of help.
Well, in that case, I guess we have no choice.
King Moore's killing.
Here he comes.
I guess you can learn a lot on a cattle drive. If you live that long.
The kid from the summer of 42 grows up fast on the great cattle drive of 1866.
When you have to shoot, shoot. Don't talk.
Okay, guys, the VHS Voyage this week is Homebodies. This is a bootleg. I actually don't have the real copy of the movie, but really enjoy this one, Homebodies. If you guys never seen this one, made in, I think, 80, it follows the story of these old people who are going to be evicted and kicked out of the only place they've ever really known for the last 30 years. They live in this, I think it's Cincinnati, is it, when the movie takes place in? This, like, apartment building, and they're tearing everything down and moving them out. There's six old people living in this building, and you really feel bad for them. They established the characters well. We have a strange agoraphobic woman who never, ever left her house. She used to live high class. She lives completely isolated. We have the lead lady. I guess she's the lead. I don't know, really necessarily know if there's one lead or not. We have an old man who has been writing his wife's memoirs, who passed away. We have a couple, and then we have... The couple are always together. They live for each other. We have a blind old man who's kind of eccentric, and the lead who, you know, has a mean streak. That's the basic setup of the movie. They don't want to move out, and it turns into a horror movie. We have a real mean social worker, too, that comes in, and you generally feel sorry for them. Her lack of apathy. She has zero care for any of these. Her lack of, sympathy is what I should say. But, so there's a construction site nearby, and they know that they're coming for them. So what you start to realize is a construction worker actually falls and dies, and they stop tearing down for a minute, and they stop building for a minute. And this gives them an idea. Or was the idea always there? They start to sabotage the entire work site, getting people killed so that they can live there longer. And it escalates, and people start to end up murdered, and they start killing people. And this is a jet black comedy, to be honest. There's really fun moments where they end up putting someone they murdered in a wheelchair, and they have to push them across the city, and some other old lady tries to help them out. Is she a cripple? And they're like, get away, get away. Lots of gags like that. Old woman has to drive a car. She hasn't driven a car in 30 years. Jokes ensue. So it's a jet black comedy about murder and about getting, about that kind of stuff. There's a great chase scene in here. It's slow motion, kind of resembling the old people. They get in paddle boats and they're chasing each other. That's really funny. And there starts to be turmoil within the group as well. I like the setting that it takes place in this old house, and I like that these old people decide to fight back. In a way, it starts off as, righteous, yeah, and then it becomes, they start to engulf themselves in their own thing. But I'd really recommend checking this one out. It's got a great plot. It's well acted. It's very funny. Very, very funny. And I wish it was a little bit more known. Jet black comedy about old people killing people to live where they want to live. And I guess it makes a statement about that. And the ending is very bizarre. But I love the performance of the agoraphobic woman who refuses to leave her apartment. I genuinely feel sorry for her throughout the entire movie. But I also like the whole city, landscape and stuff, and all these old people moving about it and whatnot. Good stuff. Really cool movie, and I recommend it. All good characters.
Is she dead? I think so. Who is she? Is she the girl they sent from the city? Yes. She was coming for me. Yes. What if somebody finds out? Gotta hide her.
Okay, the pick a movie I watched on Netflix streaming. It is The Night Comes for Us. Jason Willard picked this one. This is by the guys who did The Raid, which I thought was pretty cool. I didn't love The Raid. They did The Raid 2 as well. And they did the segment in VHS 2 about the cult, which is amazing. But this is The Night Comes for Us. Off the bat, this movie comes off as a little confusing of a setup. But after a while, you catch on what's happening here. And after that, I was completely in. I thought this was one of the best movies I saw in a long time. Our lead character here, he is part of, I don't want to spoil too much, but he is kind of in the Yakuza, and he does something to upset the Yakuza, goes back home, kind of meets up with some of his old gang members, and they send a bunch of hitmen and people to kill him. But he is a one-man wrecking crew, and him and his friends decide to fight back. After this is all, he does something, he tries to save a child and takes the kid with him, and they want the kid dead as a witness. But that's the plot of the movie. They're after the kid. And they're after him, and he has to defend himself. And that's the whole setup. One of the characters after him also has a history. They used to be friends. And crazy action ensues. This movie has some great fight scenes, but what it has more so is cringeworthy violence. I can't believe some of the stuff they did in here. Mostly practical, mostly amazing. Squibs going off. The fight scenes are tight and choreographed, and they're great. They're awesome. The lead has a lot of charisma. He's a good actor, and he can fight. And it's just perfect. I'd like to see this guy be the next action hero. I'd like to see him be the next Jean-Claude Van Damme, even though I think he's a better actor than Jean-Claude Van Damme. I'd like to see him be that next guy because I think he's good enough to be it. But just amazing fight scenes in here. It's emotional, especially the chemistry with the characters at the end. And there's just some characters in here that are outstanding, especially in the fights when one of the characters dies. The bad guys are really cool. Like, they're awesome. They have their own gimmicks, their own weapons. It's just a really damn cool movie. And I don't think I ever cringe so bad at some of the stuff. One of the characters, they're fighting, and I don't want to spoil too much, but they stop for a second. Like, there's a breath in the fight, and they pull off their finger because it's just barely hanging on there. And I was just like, oh my God, there's stuff where a character gets something through their arm and they pull it and it splits it. And I was just like, and it's all like, a lot of that's practical stuff. And it's just tremendous, tremendous. And fight scene, great. It goes on forever and every second's worth it. Regardless, I'd really recommend checking it out. It's well made. It's top notch. There's great fight scenes. Like I said, the opening starts to be a little confusing with all these characters coming in and their motivations and who they are. But after a while, you know what's going on and you're in the full ride. The ending's also great. Don't want to spoil it by telling the movie it reminds me of because it will directly spoil it. But recommended highly. Great stuff. The Night Comes for Us. High action, high violence, great choreographed stuff. If you like martial arts movies, if you like fight movies, if you like action movies, this feels like an action movie. But with from back in the day, with just more gore, so it's great. I can't recommend it enough.
3 tahun gue jadi mesin pembunuh mereka. Gak kehitung pembantaian yang udah gue lakuin. Kalau lo sudah dilantik menjadi seorang sixes, hukumnya mutlak. Jangan pernah mengampuni. Tapi di saat itulah gue melihat satu kehidupan kecil yang sudah di ujung tanduk. Mungkin. Mungkin aja gue bisa merubah taktis gue.
Gue gak ngira akan berakhir kayak gini tuh.
Apa yang gue lakuin sekarang? Yang harusnya gue lakuin dari dulu.
Berani banget lo ngomong kayak gitu.
Mending lo siap-siap sekarang.
Sekarang.
Okay, let's do the pick a movie drawings. Like I said, the pick a movie drawings. We're going to finish up this bag, then we're going to finish up the new bag, and it's gone. So, who's going to win? Who we got? We got Raymond Pierce. Raymond Pierce, let me know what you want to watch. And I guess now we're going to get into... What is it? The questions. Okay, I had some questions. David Lether. Dear Mr. Parker, have you seen In a Glass Cage? Yes, I have. That's a tremendous movie, but it's been a very, very long time. Maybe somebody wants to pick it for a Patreon pick, but I really like that movie. I remember it being pretty twisted. I also saw another one of his movies. Maybe I saw a couple of his movies, actually. Black Bread and Moon Knight or Moon Baby? I can't remember what it was called. Nick Mua. I wanted to fork over some bucks to your Patreon. I don't have a credit card linked to my PayPal. Could I write the amount for my PayPal to yours instead? I don't know. We'll have to figure that out. I'm not sure. We might. I don't know. I'll just send me a message or something. If you could come back as a zombie, would you prefer a Romero-type zombie or a Haitian magical walking corpse under the thumb of Bokor? Or Romero zombie, you're pretty brain dead. You're only running on the... I love those zombies, but I don't want to be one of them. I don't want to be one of them things. I guess I would say a Haitian magical zombie because I think there's a chance to break that spell. What's your favorite silent film? I was always partial to Nosferatu. You know what? Silent films are a pretty big weakness in, you know, for me. I would have to say Nosferatu as well. We have some old answers to the question. I said what, you know, folky song or 70s song, like, song was made perfect for a movie. I think some people misinterpreted what I was saying, but that's okay. We have Ben Miller, Night of Death, 1980. End song fits super well and has that tragic tone. Plays right at the end as the credits roll. If you haven't seen this one yet, please do someday. I do have it. I need to watch it. Visitor Q, Real Time. Bubbles of Water fits super well and just reminds me early of the 2000s, pre-9/11 somehow. Bigger fan of the song than the movie itself. Ben Miller definitely got it, but he was right on picking what he did. This is what I kind of meant. A lot of people got it right. Some people got it wrong. Don't Torture a Duckling. I'm not going to say the guy who sings this song, but the song played by Balkan's Beating, such a horrific, beautiful scene. I completely agree. I mean, I talked about that scene in depth in the review and with Joe Rubin. That's one of my all-time favorite scenes, and that scene is one of my favorite songs. That's one of my favorite scenes, and that's one of my favorite songs, to be honest. I love that song. Devil's Rejects, all the montages, especially the parts with Terry Reid. Became a fan after that one. Yeah, Devil's Rejects has great musical choices. Blue Velvet, In Dreams by Roy Orbison, the scene where Hooper gets even less stable. Come back to that one a lot. That's a good song. Fritz the Cat, Yesterday, sung by Billy Holly, as well as Dunn scene in the Rundown Dirty Dirty City Streets. Okay. Bella Donna of Sadness, the entire psychedelic jazz score by Masahato Sato, but mainly the main theme songs, especially right at the end. Wild Geese, Flight of the Wild Geese by Joan Armatrading during the opening credit sequence. Wizards, the song Time Will Tell, used well in a really sad scene. I still don't get how that thing has a PG. Wicker Boy, the Tenebra theme, Goblin. Exorcist Tubular Bells by Mike Oldfield and Scarface, Tony's theme, Giorgio Moroder, has always been some of my favorite music. For me, Riz Ortolani, Cannibal Holocaust music was perfect for the tone of the film. You hear the music and you naturally think of sadness. But if I was going to choose a song with words, I would choose Push It to the Limit by Paul Edgeman, Scarface. The montage scene is so freaking awesome. That song is awesome. See, I couldn't even help but sing it when I brought it up. Rockmaster Flash, he posted a link to a song. I think this is what he's getting at. Get With It, Azatik Crew. No explanation. Maybe it was just an advertisement. I don't know. New answers. I asked any celebrity death matches you guys would have liked to see. Nick Mua. Gary Oldman versus Gerard Butler. Both were excellent as Dracula. I wonder who would come out on top. Dame Maggie Smith and Imelda Staunton. Those ladies made such great nemesis in the Potterverse. Their fight would be magical indeed. Lastly, they almost ate one another on Hannibal, the TV show. Gillian Anderson versus Mads Mikkelsen would be delicious delight to unfold. Ilk Vomit. Warwick Davis versus Phil Fondacaro is a fight that would be a visual feast for the eyes. The Wicker Boy. Bruce Campbell versus Tony Todd. One is a chainsaw, the other a hook could be interesting. Peek and Boo, I'd like to see a match between John Cena and Gojira. Godzilla, don't ask. The M. Brown 80, gosh, there's so many I'd pay to see duke it out. Bella versus Boris, Bela versus Boris, Ed Wood versus Uli Bull, and Ron Jeremy versus John Holmes. Southport Rocker, as for a celebrity death match, first that came to mind is Charles Bronson around the Mechanic to Death I Wish era versus Clint Eastwood Dirty Harry era. That would be cool. Tempo Tapas, my choice for the celebrity death match is Jim Carrey versus Jimmy Stewart and Debbie Mazar versus Firzuka Bulk. That's a great one too, because those two I always confuse. And Tempo Tapas had an idea, which made me think, I actually had this idea beforehand, like do the question, have like the Patreon where people can directly send me and ask a question for the crowd. And so this goes right into the question of the week, the new question of the week. Tempo Tapas wanted to know, a great question of the week would be this, and I agree. So this is the question of the week. He said, here's an idea for a question. Which two actors have never been in the same movie do you wish would work together? I would love to see Bruce Campbell and Jeffrey Combs in a horror comedy. There's a bunch. So yeah, I'm trying to think. Like I said, I would have loved to see tons of these guys work together. I don't have any off the top of my head. I'll answer with you guys next week if I remember. All right, so that's the question of the week. Which two actors would you like to see work together that never got a chance to do it? I guess we'll go into the update now. Okay, guys, let's hop into the update. Got some couple 4K ones. We got American Psycho. Haven't seen this in a long time. Didn't even have the Blu-ray, just had the DVD. So Black Friday, $8.99. Decided to grab it. You know, I'm not the world's biggest Christian Bale fan, but I think he's amazing in this movie. If I remember correctly, it's been a very long time. So, you know, $9, couldn't pass that up. Then we have another 4K. We have Halloween. Again, $9. Not buying everything on 4K when it's released, but for $9, I will grab Halloween, the John Carpenter classic. I lied, I think, a long time ago when I bought that Halloween box when I said, I'm never buying Halloween again. Yeah, they got me. Then we have Blu-rays, Murder Rock by Lucio Fulci. You know, I've seen this one a long time ago. It's Fulci. It's not very gory, I remember. I remember it's in a dance studio. I think this is Code Red or Scorpion releasing. So, you know, couldn't really pass up Fulci on Blu-ray. You know, I'm a sucker for all of it. Then we have Twilight Time had a sale. We got Fat City with Stacey Keach, Jeff Bridges. Susan Tyrell's in this as well. It's by John Huston. Never seen it. Only heard good things. I know the Pure Cinema podcast, they are big fans of this one. So I wanted to check it out. Let me get a little tighter in on there. There we go. Yeah, but looks cool. Black and white. Big made in 80. We have State of Grace, which I remember having one of the best shootouts at the very end. Sean Penn, Gary Oldman, Ed Harris. Good cast. Irish mobster movie from Twilight Time. I remember liking this movie, but I remember the shootout being one of the best shootouts I've seen in a very long time. Then right like a day after I bought this, they announced that it was getting another release from Kino. Scream and Scream Again. Paid $7 for it. You know what's funny? I love the cast. Vincent Price, Peter Cushing, Christopher Lee, all in this movie. But this is not a particularly great movie. I don't really like it that much. So, you know, for $7, it was a good buy. But I don't think I'll be buying that Kino unless it's like $8. So we got Munchies and Munchie, double feature from Scream. I wish I wouldn't have bought this because I paid $25 for this. It's just too much, right? But I'm a little creature, a sucker, so, you know, you order these things thinking the price is going to go down, and then you're like, it didn't? Oh my God, I just paid $25 for Munchies. But yeah, that's how it goes. And then we have this awesome box set from Scream Factory. Go a little wider here. Critters, yeah, Critters Collection, all four Critters movies, yeah, was it Critters 1, Critters 2, The Main Course, Critters 3, and Critters 4, I really like Critters 1 and 2, last time I tried to watch Critters 3, I could not make it through, and Critters 4 I've never liked, so, yeah, but it is worth it, they weren't very expensive for the Critters set, and then we have some DVDs that I grabbed at, Family Video, Dead Night. These were like 3 for $6, so I grabbed 3. I don't know what this is. Looked pretty interesting. Then we have, what is this one? Primal Rage. And this is not to be confused with the old Primal Rage that was put out by Code Red, obviously. But yeah, Bigfoot movie. Don't know if it's any good. And we have Minutes to Midnight. Pray These Strangers Don't Come Calling. I don't know. Uncorked Entertainment, I think. But those were all $6 together. But back to the video. All right, guys, we're going to do the couple Patreon shout-outs. We have Chris Rivers, thank you very much, and DRS, thank you again. Those are the only two Patreon shout-outs, but if you guys want to join, it's right below. Check out what I got to offer. And no need to feel pressured or anything like that. But thank you very much, guys, for watching, as always, and you guys have a good one.